Ajay Bakshi is a neurosurgeon by training, then worked with McKinsey for a few years, has experience of leading big corporate hospitals. He was with the Manipal Group and the Max Group, and is now starting his own startup, which is about 2 weeks old. Dr. Santanu was with the National Health Service, NHS UK, for a few years, then came back, started Nationwide Primary Healthcare. It's a network of greenfield primary healthcare hospitals in the country. He's also had experience with other healthcare companies with leadership and mentorship roles. Arun Prabhu is a partner with Cyril Amarchand Mangaldas. And Priya, Karnik is a volunteer with iSPIRT. She's a health tech maven for us. So good to have everybody on the panel. So just initial thoughts, Dr. Santanu, Arun, and Dr. Bakshi, on the health tech.
Yeah, I think if I look at a very 50,000 feet view, you know, healthcare as an industry cannot work only, solution cannot be only private. I mean, that is my first submission. I mean, you normally say, you know, government needs to do very few governments and leave it to market. Healthcare, if you leave it to market, it will not work. I mean, that's what my view is. So from that principle standpoint view, you need to create those kind of infrastructure which can be publicly funded or something on which it needs to build. That doesn't mean that private has got no role, but there has to be So that's my point number one. So if there is a requirement. Now, what all you build up, obviously, that's there are a lot of things to build up. I'm a big proponent of primary care, although I'm actually a gastroenterologist practicing in the UK for a long time. I have seen a very good primary care system while practicing in the UK and that's it. And some of these problems, what we were talking, for example, what happens today? I mean, if you think practically, it's slightly different in rural and urban. If I'm in Bangalore, this part of the town, if I have a tummy pain, I will go across the hospital, Manipal. Somebody will say, okay, you have a tummy pain, so that guy, the front office, will try to diagnose me with some kind of either kidney or this thing. He'll push me to a specialist. Specialist may look me through that home. If he's a gastroenterologist, he'll say endoscopy. So he'll do procedures because you get paid by procedures, that's not him. So that's what happens. This is not primary care, this is not tertiary care. There is a model built on profitability of the hospital and how does IOS run hospital also in between. Basically, you create procedures. Yeah? You get a lot of patients see at a very subsidized rate in outpatient and then you create procedures. So from that point of view, and in rural area, you have probably the quacks or non-qualified doctors providing. So that's pretty key. So from that point of view, you have to start, you are probably right, starting from the right range, like first creating a health registry. You know, if we have to deliver primary care, I mean, because as you correctly said, we started with in the primary care in the phase one, not only nationwide, there are 7, 5, 6 others. We started with the concept of creating a parallel system, you know. And if I look back, it was starting in 2010 I started. This is like the analogy of Meru versus Uber, right? You create a fantastic system, fantastic car, who will rest, will be a driver, etc. It didn't work, right? But you have already a system that is working. So everybody provides primary care. Like in village, it is provided by a quack, and in Manipal, it's provided by interventional cardiologist. He's also doing primary care, right? So the first thing to do is in line with what I agree that the first thing is to create a registry. Who can provide what and the second, I think that somebody has already touched upon what in my view will be AI will play a very, very important role. Because while in urban area we have excess of doctors, the government is not able to still after 70 years send enough doctors to the village. And it will never happen because there's social infrastructure lacking. It's not how much money you give. So you have, I think they have already started looking at alternate solutions. Like, you say bridge doctors. You take somebody who is a ICE doctor, train them. But this is where the AI can, in some ways, like a clinical.
You mean AI clinical decision?
Decision support. That's what I was saying. That if you can combine this, like we have seen in the West, nurse practitioner, give them a tool. Yeah. In nationwide, I was a big proponent of training doctors, but then there is an end to it. It's not scalable, right? But if you can create a tool which they can use, then that can be used. And the third, in terms of a claim management, I think again there is an essential problem because we spoke about this primary care copay, but the problem, there is a problem in business model itself. Insurance, business model is what? I mean, 100 people will pay, only one people will claim. Everybody will claim primary care. How do we solve this problem? And that's why there's no player in primary care. Primary care is not covered by insurance today. It's simply this business model does not work. So that needs to be solved as well.
Could you explain that in English?
Simple. We have, let's take iSPIRT Bharat. Yeah. So 100 people are paying, but out of that, maybe one person will claim. So everybody needs an OPD care. So where is the business model? I will be paying, so it's a prepaid model. It's not insurance. B, there is a lot of chance of fraud. I can just go and somebody and he gives to a friend and he will write a prescription. So that's something what we need to look at. How do you build up a primary care insurance and how do you study stop fraud when the people are already started? So I think these are my initial thoughts in the context of primary care holistic compassion. I'm sure Dr. Bakshi can talk about hospitals.
Yeah.
So my first reaction to health tech is brilliant. I think it's spot on, it's what the country needs. And it reminded me of the Pankaj Gupta's book called Revolution from the Top, where he talks about that if you want to build a strong society, you have to have basic healthcare and basic education. Healthcare secures you today, and education secures you tomorrow. And I think as a society, we have failed in both over the last 70 years of independence. And all of us over here are the middle class intellectuals. I take the burden on myself, on us, on this class, that we haven't solved it. I'm delighted that people like all of you are working on it. So congratulations for that. It's ambitious and it's long term. It's not going to happen anytime soon. So I think that's something we have to keep in mind. Having said that, I fully agree with what Dr. Santanu is saying, is that healthcare is a social good. And nowhere in the world has a pure to solve it. Because the private incentives are such. In fact, the worst case study of this is the U.S. sector, which is every sector is making 20% plus EBITDA, but the country is spending $3 trillion at last on the $3.5 trillion. So 50% of world healthcare expenditure happening in the U.S. And they have, after all the developed countries, the worst. So we don't want to go there. We can't afford it, and we know it doesn't work. So, and unfortunately, that's where we are headed. And having led three private sector hospital networks, it's very sad that we are headed that way. And some of it is because of lack of governance. Some of it is because public sector can't deliver goods because of various reasons which we don't have to go into today. So I think that is spot on. But the one point, which if Sharad was here, and I will definitely come and meet him one-on-one, is, and for all of you to consider, is that the entire universe of healthcare is built on one transaction. Because a doctor-patient transaction involves an opinion given by the doctor on the patient or a procedure performed by the doctor on the patient. It involves an investigation. It involves a drug. And it involves 3-4 other people like a nurse or a ward boy or a housekeeping staff and uncle consultants. And it's not a financial transaction, it's a qualitative transaction. In a money transaction, you have a sender, you have a receiver, you have X number of rupees, and in my mind, it's one dimension. So when you multiply the complexity of a 6-7 times more, it's much harder to build these sort of platforms and these sort of interfaces. And that's part of that thinking is part of the reason why I sort of quit my corporate job, and my co-founder is sitting here. He's a computer scientist. He's a PhD in computer science. Both of us are now trying to solve this doctor-patient interaction problem. How do you standardize this? How do you codify this? Because I fully agree with Sharad that nowhere in the world is a common nature. But there has to be a way to represent this transaction in ones and zeros, where it can be compared either to a policy or to a pharmacy transaction, what Sarath was talking about, or to a medical utilization, the whole idea of conflation or over-utilization, that this is what a normal 23-year-old primary gravidar should get, but why is he getting a cesarean, and this is not okay. And that should be automatically determined by the algorithm rather than an army or doctor sitting in insurance company. So I think there is a lot to be done there, but the core of this whole story starts from this doctor-patient interaction. And anybody who can solve that, and which is what we're trying to do, then starts to enable a whole bunch of other ideas that can be laid on top of that. I'll pause here and see if there are.
So you're right in the fact that it's all based on that one transaction. And a question to you is, since you've been in that setting, and there is, so I spent a lot of time on the field and I've realized that doctors actually are looking to have a technology, they're not technology averse. But two questions there. One, am I wrong? Is it, or is it just a myth? Or is that true? Do doctors hate technology? And second is, how do you plan to solve that?
So I think it's 100% a myth. A doctor works on a device which is called a linear accelerator, which costs 18 crores, right? And they learn it like this. Of course, it takes them years to become a radiation oncologist, but once you change it from, you know, one variant to another company, and they will pick it up. They love technology. Technology is what makes them effective. Ask him, he will love a new endoscope tomorrow. He will just take on other new features. The reason they hate information technology, because it has been forced down their throat by technologies who don't understand it, right? That they are forced. I was running Max, and Max used to have a Vista system, it's an EHR, a 1960s primitive old system. And the doctors used to come and say, you have Maro Danda on our head and imposed 99% compliance. We put every patient into the system. What do we get out of it? And my answer was an embarrassed no, nothing. You get nothing out of it. So I think there is where the IT people love to propagate this myth that doctors don't understand us. And I always tell IT people, sorry, you're wrong. You have to understand the doctor. It's not the doctor's job to understand you. You have to understand what he needs and make his life easier.
I want to say something. I just want to add an anecdote, because as I was running nationwide and later, a lot of startups come to me, technologies, and they say, I have got this and I have got this. So my favorite quote is to them, is to say that you have found a solution. Now you are trying to find a problem. Yeah? So you got the key, now you find where the lock is. Start from the other end. I give you an example. I got 3-4 companies who came to me that, oh, you know, I have got this ECG machine which can actually look at ECG 24/7. I said, what will I do with this? In my clinical practice of 10 years, I've never seen a patient who needs a 24/7 monitoring of ECG and patient is moving around. And there was one CEO of a big IT company who was telling, see, my heart is getting monitored in the back room. Why? It's called push technology, right? A lot of things you are trying to push something. And healthcare pull will work. So I think that's where the difference
is. Yeah, and I read somewhere that in the US, doctors who have bad work-life balance have lesser burnout rates, just because the ones with good work-life balance spend a lot of time with their computers. So, yeah, that's what
I'm saying. Yeah, I think very valid points. The way I look at why certain things will change. The doctor-patient interaction is important. And what we recognize and when we discuss about iSPIRT is when we look at healthcare, it's different from financial services. It is fragmented. At the same time, it's high-skilled and high-touch and high-quality. So our effort and our principle has always been, how do we design blocks that will enable, equip the doctor to do their job better, assist, like the CDSs that you mentioned. And so things like augmenting the capacity of the doctor, things like making sure, you know, there's a referral system, maybe ensuring continuum of care. The second view is, as ecosystems emerge, as you're seeing startups today, right? There is an increasing realization as a startup, which may not be DNA of a large established IT company, is if you want to succeed, you need to make sure you delight the customer. Right? those start to succeed. And hopefully the principles that you spoke about, will try to understand the consumer cost. And that is what is happening in a lot of financial services technology. How do I minimize the clicks? How do I focus, so much focus on the UI design? And this has been a phenomenon which is happening soon. Right? So hoping that that will also percolate to healthcare. That's another point. Third, you spoke about OPD. I completely understand if the probability of taking that is 100%, it's not an insurance product. Right? Our view is by reducing the operational by increasing operational efficiency and reducing operational costs, insurers can introduce micro insurance policies. So, if you're in the market today, if you take a health insurance policy, your typical premium is 4,000, 5,000 rupees per annum. Now, if you want to go to Bharat, nobody is going to buy their first insurance policy by paying 4,000 rupees, especially when there are so many exclusion clauses. And that's a different thing. But hopefully, you can create a micro slice for that and say, if you get hospitalized, you have hospital cash products. If you get hospitalized for a certain number of days, I'll pay you this. And the premium for this is 500 rupees. And people are willing to try that out. This is similar to what happened in the mutual fund industry, right? You have now with 100 rupees, you can start your first mutual fund instrument, and providing you invest in the right mutual fund instrument, you can start off. You don't need 5,000, you don't need 10,000. So the accessibility can improve a great deal if the costs of processing would come down. So that's the perspective that I want. Sure.
A lot of doctors do not want to incorporate information technology, especially from the patient management point of view, because they want to stay away from the accountability. The money trail part, how many patients, how much revenue they are making, especially in the OPD setting. Now, that is a very fundamental problem. We are not even talking about expensive equipment and all. But if you are not able to crack that part, the information technology part there, they have that scare, maybe founded, maybe unfounded, that they don't want to come into the formalized tool. How do you react to that? Is this a big problem? Is this not? And how can we?
Sure. So I think it is a valid problem. And it's not only the fear of the taxman, which is keeping them away. It's also the way the economics of a GP practice in a tier 3 town works. And I'm going to be a bit blunt here, because I don't know how to be politically correct. A typical GP makes 200 rupees per consultation, or maybe even 100 rupees, 150 rupees. But he gets 20,000 rupees from a big corporate hospital when he refers a angioplasty or any resection. So one referral is equal to 100 patients, or maybe even more. I know Nationwide is one of the rare successes, but there are many other people have tried. Organized primary care fails because unless you do this stuff, you don't make money on that stuff, right? On the per transaction. And they're obviously afraid of that. Now, this is all predicated on information asymmetry. The GP knows a lot more about the patient and a lot more about where to send the patient, where the patient doesn't know that enough. That is fundamentally what we are attacking in Buddhimed. We are saying that we will give the information to you. Who's your doctor? How many cases he has done? How many outcomes has he re-explored? Or how many patients has he re-explored within 30 days? All the information is there. It is sitting somewhere either in the insurance company or in the TPA or in the hospital. If somebody has to make that available, and in the end, that's what health stack will also achieve. If all the Ayushman transactions transparently are available to you, not in a, and I know Arun is sitting here, I have to be very careful, without breaching any data privacy, in an aggregated manner. It is a mahashastra, whatever you want to call it, which will flatten this entire story of non-willingness to participate, because you will not get patients anymore. When you have the transparency that you're only optioning your patients to a Medanta or a Max or Manipal or whatever that is, right? So that's my answer, that information asymmetry, once it is removed, a lot of these problems will go away. and which is what some of these efforts will lead us to.
Yeah, and we also believe that value-added services will be built on top of these registries. The idea is to incentivize good ecosystem. The system will evolve to incentivize good players in the ecosystem. There is a lack of trust, and that showed up.
There is also, just one thing, there are also regulations with the Data Protection Authority coming in, which mandates that some amount of data, the patient has control over his data. Arun, maybe you could spend a minute on that.
Sure.
So and then you could get that.
I just pull back 2 steps, right? And when it comes to things which have a visceral, emotional sort of connection to all of us, like healthcare, you know, these things are often tested in breach. They're not tested when you know, in terms of operational efficiency, margin improvement. Those are economic concepts. They apply to a certain part of the brain. But 10,000 people's healthcare data breached, or Dash is selling healthcare data to somebody. That has an emotional sort of hindbrain appeal. And then you throw the baby out with the bathwater, because human beings are definitely emotional sort of animals. So whatever framework we move ahead with, and I'm fully aligned with the experts here that there needs to be a framework and it needs to be a functional framework. That framework will essentially be tested in breach. So how do you breach-proof something like this? You breach-proof it in some way by getting buy-in, by getting involvement of the participants in a real and tangible manner. Now, Sharad touched on this very briefly when he was making his thing. The way we have looked to solve it as India is, and Dr. Shri Krishna has done an incredible job of sort of looking at various legal regimes globally and arriving at a solution, is through the element of consent. Where you exercise your autonomy in relation to your information, not by means of ownership, which is by itself a very coarse and difficult concept to define when it comes to information, not by means of a liability or negligence, which is the regime today, which is jo chahe karo, but leak hua to, it's on your head. You know, the negligence-based regime which is there today, and we all know how effective it is. Not by either of those two concepts, but by the concept of consent, where I say, do this, don't do this. Okay? So, to my mind, one of the key elements of any sort of construct that has to be built is to have granular and visible, coherent consent for the participants in a healthcare ecosystem. And Dr. Bakshi said this very well, right? At the core of this ecosystem is a doctor-patient relationship. That is a relationship of trust. For those of you who have interacted in the insurance space or in the legal space with advisors, you will understand there is a very strong fiduciary aspect to this relationship of trust. Not only are you required to do as the patient says, or as your insured says, or as your attorney client, your client says, but you are also required to know what is best in that person's best interest and act according to that. And interestingly, the data protection framework in India incorporates that element. It also incorporates an element of consent dashboards, of a consent score, which is basically a market-based mechanism to make consents more comprehensible and granular and therefore accessible to people. There's really no point in me sitting and putting together a 50-page consent document if, you know, you're talking about India 2, India 3 accessing it, where even a very, very simple sort of yes or no is very, very difficult to process, right? The choice that you put before somebody can't be, do you want healthcare or do you not? Because that's a very easy choice for anybody to make. So consent has to be more granular. And there's just one last thing I'll sort of leave this, this group with, and then we can maybe drill down on it a little more. When does your data stop being your data, right? Because, again, just treating data like any other asset runs this pitfall or this policy of equivalence. If you create a financial asset or you create a real asset, a tangible asset, that asset has boundaries. You can say, okay, here is this painting which I've done. With healthcare information, it's very difficult. It's only your healthcare information till the point that you're capable of being identified from that information. Second, there is a tremendous amount of value which is to be derived from aggregating large volumes of that information and running complex analysis on it. And this value is real, it is tangible, it is effective on a day-to-day basis, it is actually life-saving information.
If you know for a fact that there is a incidence of influenza spreading in location dash, you can literally save lives by being able to react to it immediately. So in the healthcare space, much more so than the financial space, much more so than, for instance, and at the risk of being slightly unpopular, the unique identification space, to my mind, there is a very strong case for allowing the use of information which is no longer capable of identifying an individual in order to help prevent disease and save costs, which can also mean the same thing.
So the analytics framework of the healthcare actually addresses that, but I'm not getting into the details in the session. Apathic acid post.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Ramesh, cardiologist and investor. Probably didn't have time when Sam was there with the question of something else, a universal health record. Far more challenging. But I think, like, for example, like, I can't go to a bank and draw 10 rupees not having a trail. I think in the healthcare system, I think, okay, may not be universally same health record everywhere. I think every transaction has to be documented. Assuming they go to a small diagnostic lab or a large diagnostic lab, a government hospital or a private hospital, whatever that interaction is, has to be recorded. And people say India doesn't have money, that's not correct. All state governments have given laptops free before the elections to everyone. And before the elections, probably my own government, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, they almost promised a lakh of rupees for every person every year. So I think every healthcare worker can be given a laptop or an iPad. And I think every transaction is recorded in whatever format it is. And the technical language I can't understand. Unless that happens, whatever we are talking, I think probably a few registries like National Cancer Registries don't help unless we capture the entire data in the country.
I think you're spot on, sir, if I may. Yeah.
No, I will say,
he's talking about beyond the stuff. So I think also, Ramesh, you're spot on. I think the one nuance I'd like to bring to for everybody's consideration is that, building on what Arun was saying, if the owner of the information is the patient, make it worthwhile for the patient or the well person. I don't want to call patients because millions of people are healthy. They also own or should own and have interest in their own information being uploaded into the system. And I'm encouraged by the fact that if you walk around anywhere in India, people are taking selfies. Selfie is your external body. Your internal health information is also a selfie in a way. It's a deeper selfie. It's your ECG, it's your retina PET scan, whatever it is. But the problem is, asking them to upload it on this EHR system with no benefit to them or the doctor is of no use. So I think that's something that some of us had to design, where it is in the interest of, you know, Mrs. Rajamma living in Chittor to say, yes, I want this on my record, so that when I go to a doctor, I can show it to him, or when I go to a pharmacy, I can get faster treatment. So I think that's an unsolved problem, but in my mind, again, at the risk of being unpopular, it is never going to be solved by a governmental agency or a hospital network or a nurse by forcing them to do it. We have to create pull where the person says that this is my record, I want it. And in fact, Eric Topol talks about it. He says a digital twin, a homo digitus, that you create a digital replica of yourself on the digital space and you own it. And then, therefore, it's your sort of in best interest to do that. Have you tried entering into Microsoft? I as a doctor, as a tech savvy person, it took me 45 minutes, and after that, I gave up because I could not enter the report. It was a technologist with a solution searching for a problem.